Good evening.
Good evening.
It's Thursday, March 21st. This is a work session of the Newburgh City Council. I have a motion to go into executive session.
So moved.
Second.
Yep.
All in favor?
Aye.
I have a motion to come out of executive session.
So moved.
Second.
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 All in favor?
Aye.
Due to the size of the crowd this evening and the obvious issues and severity of the topics to be discussed, excuse me all, please.
Un momento.
Is the mic on?
Due to the size of the crowd this evening, we are going to be going out of order and discussing number 18 first prior to any of the presentations. Number 18 on the agenda this evening is local laws related to municipal identification card program.
So what you have in your packets is a draft local law.
Your mic is?
One.
No, it's... Share. Oh, there you go.
Testing.
Okay.
That one's working. Thank you.
In your packets, members of council, there is a proposed local law. I have suggested creating a Chapter 60 in the administration portion of the city code to create a municipal identification card program for the city of Newburgh. It is substantially similar to the local laws adopted in the cities of Middletown and the city of Beacon. And there is some legislative background and some findings and purpose you'll find there. There will be a program. The city will, following adoption and an implementation phase, the city will be proposing to implement a card program. Right now it's scheduled to begin for anybody over the age of 14. Obviously that's something that if you saw a need to change, we could change. The municipal ID card will have a certain design and features so that it will try to minimize fraud. We propose to have fees associated with issuing these cards, but that will come later. There's a draft ordinance in your packets that talk about that as well. That's something for a little bit later. There is a proposed schedule for how people can make an application for the ID. They have to prove that they are who they are, that's proof of identity, and they would also have to prove residency here in the city of Newburgh. And what you see on page 4 and 5 of your local law are the methods by which those they can achieve those goals. So there's a series of documents that would allow them to prove who they are, whether it be a foreign passport or some other photo ID that they might have from another location. And then there would be a way to prove that they are residents of the city of Newburgh, which include things from utility bills to having a student in the school district based on a city address. So there's a whole list of ways that they can prove that. The city would make sure that those items are checked. The city would not retain copies or retain the documents that are submitted as the basis to form the IDs. And we would keep as much information confidential as we could. The city clerk's office would be charged with issuing the IDs, and it would provide access to some services, and we have also begun reaching out to banks and some of the other local institutions to see how municipal ID card could be utilized within the city of Newburgh.
Michelle, quick question back to all of when you were referencing what documents they would need in order to prove city residence, is it like just one or two of the documents? Yeah. That's not clear.
I have, right now what I'm proposing is to have, you need 4 points to prove who you are, to prove your identity. Okay. And there's a series of documents on page 4 that would be 4 points or 3 points, where in any combination you would be able to prove that I am, that Michelle Kelson is who Michelle Kelson says she is. And then the residency, it's only 1 point. So the proposed law makes it relatively easy to prove that you live. A rental agreement, a utility bill, any kind of jury summons, an insurance card, even so much as a verification that you have utilized certain social and homeless services within the city of Newburgh. So even if you're someone who does not have a permanent fixed address, there is a mechanism by which you would be able to establish some type of residency tie to the city of Newburgh. So I've tried to keep the floor, as it were, as low as possible, and to facilitate access as much as possible for anybody who might need to have this type of service. And again, anybody can go and look at the city of Middletown's local law, and they can look at the city of Beacon's local law and see that what we're proposing here is incredibly similar. And they seem to be doing a good job over there, and I didn't think it would be necessary to completely reinvent the wheel.
Okay.
And all of this is modeled after the New York City law, which was the first one in part of the country.
So todos los gentes en el gobierno de la ciudad soporte la ley de local para toda la identificación para los gentes en la ciudad. Todos los gentes aquí en el gobierno de la ciudad soporte esa ley. Okay? There's no problema. We're waiting for this. We're excited about this. This is going to happen in Newburgh.
So, bueno, primeramente le quería decir a todos ustedes buenas noches. Muchísimas gracias por venir a su alcaldía. Como dijo el alcalde Torrance Harvey, él es el que nos da todo el principio de la información y yo les quiero dar los detalles de la ley que estamos proponiendo. Como dijo la consejera Michelle Kelson, que es la abogada de la ciudad de Newburgh, hemos estado viendo todos los modelos, empezando con el modelo de identificación que la ciudad de Nueva York ocupa. Sabemos que ya en Middletown, esta fue la primera semana, o empezando desde la semana antepasada, que ya empezaron a dar la identificación. So, lo que va a pasar aquí en la ciudad de Newburgh va a ser igual. Básicamente vamos a tener un sistema de puntos, 4 puntos se van a necesitar para identificar quién es usted. Puede usar su pasaporte de su nacionalidad, cualquier tipo de identificación que tenga, y va a estar especificado en los detalles de la ley. So, son 4 puntos para tener la identidad y decir, sí, yo soy Karen Mejía. Y 1 punto nada más para identificar que usted sí es residente de la ciudad de Newburgh. Ya puede hacer eso un lease que tengan de vivienda o un bill que les haya llegado ya de Central Hudson o cualquier cosa que tengan así, que tenga su nombre y su dirección para comprobar que sí es residente de la ciudad de Newburgh. Como dijo el alcalde, esto es algo que todos los miembros del concejal apoyan. Me alegra que ustedes vengan, no solamente esta noche para este tema, pero por favor, lo hemos estado diciendo desde que pasamos la resolución para hacer una ciudad santuaria, que ustedes tienen que venir a la municipalidad, tienen que venir a participar, no solo cuando sean temas así, sino constantemente. Ustedes no saben cuánta alegría me da ver a todas estas caras que están aquí esta noche y cuánto los extraño cuando ustedes no están acá. So, muchísimas gracias por venir esta noche y recuerden que hoy lo que vamos a dar es a pasar una resolución para el lunes. El lunes es cuando votamos y el lunes lo que dice es que vamos a tener lo que le llaman un public hearing, que eso va a ser en abril. Y eso es porque cada vez que cada municipalidad pasa una ley, por resolución, por el charter que nosotros tenemos, tenemos que tener lo que le llaman un public hearing, que es cuando todas las personas de la ciudad, similarmente cuando hicimos la resolución del Sanctuary City, ¿se acuerdan que vinieron todas las personas, podían hablar? Eso es lo mismo que estamos haciendo esta noche acá. So, me alegra mucho verlos a ustedes aquí en su alcaldía, y por favor regresen. The date for the public hearing?
The public hearing will be April 8th at 7 o'clock. And I think we may change the location to the activity
Ocho
center.
8 de abril a las 7 de la noche. Es una public hearing.
And one other thing, council members, we're going to work to translate the draft public hearing resolution and the draft local law into Spanish so that we can put that up on the website and everybody be able to read it.
Libertad. 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 Para toda la gente, libertad. Okay. So, Michelle, really quickly,
yes.
So are we moving it to the activity center?
I think if this, all of you people plan to come to speak at the public hearing, I think that would be a good idea.
Muchas gracias. La otra, otra.
No, solo lo, eso era lo único. Para también para rectificar, esta noche es nada más lo que le llaman la sección de trabajo, el work session. So, desafortunadamente no tenemos comentarios públicos. Los comentarios públicos se hacen los lunes. So, el lunes, si quieren y pueden, pueden venir otra vez. El comentario público, pueden hablar de cualquier cosa que tengan ustedes necesidad de hablar, ya sea de las identificaciones, condiciones de vivienda, que yo sé que bastante de nosotros tenemos muchas... tenemos muchos temas que hablar y tenemos que venir a esas reuniones. Esos tres minutos al principio, por favor, continúen venirse. Y acuérdense que el 8 de abril es cuando se va a hacer el public hearing. Y también, I mean, Ignacio sabe todo esto y él va a estar recordando, pero también ustedes sepan que es importante que regresen otra vez a dar su opinión para que el día que tomen el voto sepan qué es eso. Y para los muchachos que están aquí, que son más jóvenes que yo, más jóvenes que los padres que están acá, les quería decir que gracias por apoyar a sus padres. Gracias por estar acá. Y buenas noches.
Sí. El gusto es mío también. Muchas gracias para la gente en la ciudad. Libertad, libertad para la gente. Mi gente. Sí. Wow. Veo. Tengo buena noche también.
Oiga, pero tampoco se tienen que ir. So, si algunos de ustedes quieren quedarse para ver cómo continúa la reunión, por favor, también. Sería importante los que puedan también quedarse.
Hi, Deborah.
Bob, I see you on Saturday.
Yes.
Good night, Miss Dancy.
That's a great showing. Wow.
Ow.
I go see who's registered.
Beer.
I found it by sheer accident.
Oh, it must be in there.
Okay, we're going to move forward with the remainder of the meeting. So on Monday, we will be presenting a key to the city to a member of the water department who's been working with the city for more than 50 years. That'll be a presentation this coming Monday. As for the presentations this evening, I'd like to remind all of those who will be presenting that we do have a 10-minute limit on the presentations, first of which will be County Legislator Lujan.
Good evening, Council. Good evening. I have a member of Sustainable Warwick who's here. Would you like to introduce yourself?
Yeah, I'm Julia Calderon, and I'm the chair of the Bring Your Own Bag Committee in Warwick.
Mm-hmm. Welcome. Thank you. And I'm Orange County Legislator representing District 4 here in the city of Newburgh. I was actually thinking everyone was here for plastic bags, so I'm sad to see so many people leave. So we just want to get started. This is more of an informational session. I'm talking a little bit about what's going on in New York State, in Orange County, across the Hudson Valley. And I actually wanted to bring Julia here because she's been working on similar work in Warwick here in Orange County. And so I felt it would be a valuable resource for us. She's been really, really great in terms of reducing solid waste as an advocate. And I thought she'd be valuable for us here. Next slide, please. So just to give you an idea of what we're going to be talking about today. We're going to be discussing some of the problems associated with single-use plastic bags, current legislation across New York and beyond, the types of legislation that exist, current legislation being discussed in Orange County, New York State legislation on single-use plastic bags, and next steps that the city of Newburgh could be taking. Okay, mm-hmm. Next slide, please. I would love for you to chime in at any moment that you like. So problems associated with single-use plastic bags. As many of you know, plastic bags take up a lot of energy. They're also used, made from either petroleum or from ethylene gases, which are very, very bad for the environment. We're also talking about the impact that they have on our community, the fact that they when they get into our waterways, our rivers. As a coastal community, as a community that's along the river, these plastic bags break down, and the microplastics can get into our marine life, which are then eaten by humans, and they're very, very bad for our health. This is something that's, it's affecting us across the world. In the United States, it's a huge problem. Here in New York, it's obviously a very, really big problem. I've talked to a lot of people who work along the river, who have kayaks and so on. They spend their time cleaning up some of these plastic bags. If you're near, you see how the wind will blow a lot of the plastic bags into your neighborhoods. The impact that it has is really, really atrocious. Just the cost to our recycling centers, municipalities, the just in California alone, they spent between $300,000 to about $1 million just due to fixing machines, jamming associated with plastic bags. We're talking about not only something which is bad for the environment, bad for our health, but also really, really costly. And just, there are so many alternatives that we could be focusing on.
There really isn't any recycling of plastic bags. It's really all a sham. You bring your bags to the supermarket or whatever, and nobody knows where they go. They could get dumped in the ocean. We used to send them to China, and now China won't take them. So really, the only way is not to use them.
Could you maybe touch on also maybe some of the other factors that might be associated with plastic bags uses, either in either related to health related issues?
Okay, well, plastic bags are just like any other plastic. When they touch your food, for example, when you drink out of a water bottle that's plastic, you're absorbing certain bad chemicals called BPA, bisphenol A, and phthalates, and they really affect your hormones. They suppress male hormones, and they kind of magnify the female hormones, because BPA is like a female hormone, and they're causing a lot of diseases that we don't attribute it to that, but yes. And so when you go away and don't drink or eat anything that has BPA in it for a while, your body does clear itself. So that's something important to know, just to stop.
And as a community that's already struggling with so many contaminants in our water, adding more to them or reducing contaminants is definitely something in our interest. You'll notice that a lot of big cities, particularly those that have rivers or waterways, they have been taking a stand on this precisely because of the impact that it has on our community. Next slide, please. So just to kind of give you an idea of some of the current legislation, where you can see some of the cities, the big cities that have actually proposed this already, you can see Washington, D.C., Seattle, Boston. I also say Chicago is one of the big ones that actually implemented a really interesting law. State bans, Hawaii, California, Maryland. But more locally, this is really where it really hits home. We are actually currently the only county really in the area that doesn't have a ban on plastic bags. Dutchess County has passed one. I missed Ulster County. It's actually in the bottom. Ulster County passed a resolution, which actually was a joint ban and fee. Dutchess County passed it as well. Suffolk County, and then just recently, this past Tuesday, the Rockland County has passed it as well. And so we're really excited to see that our neighboring counties are taking a position. But obviously, in Orange County, we should be also doing quite the same. Towns and cities, a lot, for example, that should, just to kind of give you an idea in case you decided that you wanted to pass a similar resolution, I wanted to include some towns and cities here in New York State that have done it. I really particularly like the example of Piedmont. In Rockland County, they passed not only a plastic bag ban, but also a ban on styrofoam, particularly for restaurants. And this is another material which is very harmful. And there's so many other alternatives that are just easier and better for the environment. Would you like to chime in? Because I think there's...
Well, what about the nearby village of New Paltz that had it for several years? And now it doesn't need to because Ulster County has its ban. But yes, a municipality can do this. And Hawaii went municipality by municipality until the whole state was plastic bag free.
So the question becomes, and this comes up anytime we do a resolution or a ban on something. We just had a resolution to ban smoking in city parks. The first question that came up from our constituents was, how do you enforce these types of bans? Where does the enforcement come in?
Well, it's an ordinance. And for example, the best kind of law we found is a hybrid law where plastic is banned and there's a fee on paper or very thick plastic reusable bags. So it enforces itself because there's a fee on the other bags and because there isn't any plastic allowed.
So if the plastic is not allowed, now do we have law enforcement, our police officers? Who's going to police this?
Well, usually there's a fine imposed, like, of a store that keeps giving them out for free. And at first it's just a warning, then it's a $50 fine, then it's $100, you know, up to $200, up to $500.
So someone's got to issue the tickets?
No, nobody's issuing a ticket to a person who takes it. It's the actual store that has to be in charge.
Right, so who would administer or who would issue the fine?
I would think in this case the city of Newburgh.
Yeah, but who in the city?
Well,
a council
I don't know
member?
That much about city government, but there must be somebody. What?
Who? So I'd like to
who
chime
does
in.
It in Rye, New York? Who does it in Piedmont? Who's doing it in Merrimack?
I don't know, but in California it works. Somebody
in California
does.
It does. When I was in California, it's actually great. You know, you bring your bag or they can, you know, you buy a bag there. They have paper bags, but it's just changing habit. You know, if you're going to shop,
yeah,
right?
And I get that. I'm just concerned with who's going to police, and enforce a ban once we pass the resolution. Because that's what came up even with the smoking ban recently.
So that's a really great question, and that's really determined by each municipality. So, for example, in some cases, it's the health department. In some places, it was food and agriculture. It would really depend on each municipality on how they would like to enforce that.
Right.
You know, we would look to to your leadership to decide which department would be best suited for that. Ultimately, as Julia said, this was actually what we've seen, for example, in Piedmont. They've sent out a letter, you know, as a first warning. And by the second time, people have complied. And this is a process that has actually happened in most of these places for now a couple of years. Now, for example, for these, like, regionally in the Hudson Valley, of course, it's only been implemented in the last year. But so far, we've seen a lot of success and not a lot of pushback. And there's also a lot of people have mentioned about concerns about, you know, the alternatives. I mean, the alternatives are out there. So, you know, we just need to make sure that we're encouraging that. And so this is what we liked about the hybrid model. It's not just about banning and then not having something available. A lot of people have turned, for example, to paper. So the fee is actually on the use of paper, for example.
Can I just chime in? I just want to say something. Our biggest retailers is in the town of Newburgh. Big stores, Walmart, Kohl's, you know, our large shopping centers are out in the town. Mm-hmm. So really we're looking at the small bodegas And I don't know how much of an impact that they have with the plastic bags, because being so small, I have seen them use the brown paper bag as well as, you know, the bag. I want to support this, but like our mayor has said, who's going to police it? And can those small businesses be taxed again with fines from the city? Would that be another excuse to leave Newburgh? So, you know, things we would have to look at more thoroughly.
Yeah.
So
that's precisely what we're here. We're here to discuss about what if it's a feasible option in the city of Newburgh. I'd like to just continue a little bit, because I think that some of your questions actually might be answered in a future parts of the slides.
And then just a 30. Oh. Well, I guess that's the 10 minutes. But what I just wanted to quickly interject was, I'm feeling a little like guilty that I asked a lot of folks to please stay and not leave, and so I want to make sure that I'm quickly translating. So una de las cosas que estamos ahora discutiendo, estaba diciendo que me siento un poquito culpable, que les dije por favor quédense, y que no tenemos el mecanismo para hacer la traducción de inglés al español. Solo voy a hacer yo rapidito acá. But just para las personas, sería importante, si vamos a estar viniendo bastante, la ciudad puede invertir en el equipo para que no sea yo la que esté traduciendo, sino que instantáneamente ustedes lo puedan escuchar. So, eso es una de las cosas que vamos a también implementar. So, por favor, continúen a venir. Rapiditamente aquí, lo que el legislador Luján estaba hablando es de que la propuesta de prohibir el uso de las bolsas plásticas. Eso es algo que para la comunidad de nosotros, bueno, estamos regresando a Latinoamérica. Cuando estamos en Latinoamérica, cuando vamos al mercado, usamos las bolsas que traemos de las casas, no necesariamente los plásticos que tenemos. So, estamos tratando de hacer un poquito de Latinoamérica acá en la ciudad de Newburgh, y eso es lo que se está presentando aquí ahora. So, manténganse atentos y seguiré traduciendo por lo menos las partes de las presentaciones para que ustedes sepan qué es lo que se está hablando en esta mesa.
So you know, we definitely love and support this. In fact, I don't want to, you know, make it sound like I'm anti legislation on ban on plastic, because actually was talking to my history students looking at the impacts of industrialization in America, and I just read that just a few days ago there was a whale that turned up in the Philippines that died of hydration, and they found plastic inside the whale, because, you know, how does a whale die of hydration? Because of ingesting the plastic. So I've been watching this and a lot of other environmental issues recently, so I'm definitely in support of this. I definitely am, but I just really want to troubleshoot and ask the tough questions and figure out how we can collaborate with the county and the state on making sure we have the resources to police this, because it is important. It's super important to all of us.
Right. So that is part of the reason why. And so I want to thank you, Legislator Kevin Darian Lujan, for coming out. That was one of the reasons, so that we can explore it. Obviously, I am in support of it, but I do think that it has to be done the right way with the enforcement. And also, I do want to make sure that we're being mindful of our local grocery stores, that we're not putting too much of a burden on them. And also for our people who are on the lower income ring and our elderly, that we're doing something that's protective of them. I know you're not going to probably be able to get to your whole
Would the council like me to continue for a few more minutes so you can maybe get more of the
I just have I have one comment
a lot
first,
of the questions
if I can.
That you have are actually answered in
My comment would be, have you presented this to the town of Newburgh, because maybe it's something we could work in conjunction with them, because a very good point was made that all our supermarkets are really in the town, and Adams Ferric or Farms has been doing paper bags forever and ever since they opened.
And Aldi has been actually giving out cardboard boxes for, as far as I can remember, at least 10, 15 years.
I personally use the reusable bags and have been for quite some time. And I think it'll catch on. And I don't think we have to really worry too much about how it's going to be policed, although that was a good point, too, because I think people are naturally going to start to do it. I mean, part of the reason I used to shop at Adams all the time is because they had the brown paper bags. And I reused them other places. So I think it would catch on, and I think it's a great idea, but I also think we need to work in conjunction with the town of Newburgh, because that's where our people are.
Right. Right. And also, I know Nicole Anderson, she and I talk quite a bit at the county level, and I'm always trying to figure out how the city of Newburgh can tap into those shared services funds, because there's millions of dollars at the county level for shared services and the funds for shared services. So this may be a priority to say, hey, if we can get these municipalities like the town of Newburgh, the city of Newburgh, Montgomery and all the, Pine Bush, all the towns that municipalities that are in the county, if we can collaborate with you guys and tap into those shared services funds, which millions of dollars, that may be our key for this, plastic ban.
I just want to say I support this effort. There's a lot of good questions that everyone's bringing up tonight. I think it just brings us one step closer to being a climate green community, and I think that's the direction that we want to head towards. So, again, I support it, and, if you could just, I don't know what direction the Orange County is going in.
So that was in the next slide. Okay.
I also just want to take it upon myself. Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of the council. This is the first presentation we have. There's another presentation and 20 items on the agenda this evening.
Okay. Is there
can we get the PowerPoint shared with us? Because it's not in the packet.
Is there a summary slide, Mr. Lohan?
If you would like to go towards the very end, I can summarize. So essentially, the slide before that, there. So basically what we talked about in the other slides was just what we're doing in Orange County, which is the exact conversation that we're having here. You raise valid points. How are we going to enforce it? These are conversations that we're having in Orange County. These are conversations that are implemented in New York State. There's actually a task force that was created in New York State to address this. And what that report said was we need to do a hybrid. And that hybrid, what that would look like is a combination of both a fee on paper, a combination of not only just the ban, but also pushing for more recyclables in our supermarkets. Now, to the point of our Councilman Rayford, there are actually exceptions. So, for example, for example, the Ulster County model, if you receive SNAP or WIC benefits, there have been amendments that actually made sure that communities and individuals who are of greater need, that they wouldn't they would be given reusable bags at no cost to them. There are certain examples, for example, as delis, that smaller plastic bags would not be included in this. So there's a lot of these questions that are actually available through what we've been discussing in Orange County, and the legislation has been passed in Ulster, Dutchess, and so on. What I would just want to end with is what we would like to see from the city of Newburgh. If you decide to push for a ban here in the city of Newburgh, that'd be wonderful. But we would also just encourage you to consider a resolution supporting Orange County and the efforts that we're doing right now through the Green Committee. That resolution would show that there's a population of 30,000 people that are concerned about plastic bags in their community. And this would actually address the concerns that you just said. It shouldn't just be the city. It should be the town. It should be the entire county. And what I would also encourage is for a state ban. You all just sent out a letter to all your representatives. I would love to have all our representatives receiving in the state letters showing that the city of Newburgh, a community of 30,000 people that lives across the river, along the river, is supporting a ban on plastic bags, and as well as a fee. Because if we really want to address this problem, we also have to make sure that we're addressing it through a hybrid model, not just a ban.
We're definitely going to bring that resolution forward.
So I have one other question.
Please.
It's concerning plastic bag. Okay. What about the food storage bag? Because when you talked about the BPA in it, the chemical releasing into our food, maybe this can...
They're usually not included in any legislation, those bags. But on a personal level, don't put your food in that for too long. Put it in a glass jar or in a bowl in the refrigerator. But they're not included usually in any legislation.
I'm glad you have brought this up, and I'm now aware, because I am a food storage bag person. The Ziploc, freezer, there you go. But thank you so much.
And again, on top of the plastic bags, I would encourage the city to consider a ban on styrofoam, which is something else that we are looking in Orange County. And it has been passed in Ulster and Dutchess under Republican leadership in Dutchess County. So if we can do it in Dutchess County, we should definitely be doing it in Orange. All but right. It's going to take people here in this room, both on both sides of this of the table, to make it sure that this is going to happen. And so I look to all of you for that support and encouragement, because we want to get this done in Orange County, and I think that it would definitely benefit communities like ours that are along the river.
So I want to thank you, County Legislator Kevin Darien, Lujan, and
Calderon.
Yes, you also. As Mayor Harvey said, we will be bringing forth a resolution soon. Thank you.
And I want to thank the council for their time. And again, City Councilman Grice and Monteverde for your encouragement to bring forward. And Mayor, again, this a lot of the things that we need to address in the county and beyond, it's going to be together. So we thank you for your time.
Great. Appreciate
thank
you. Thank you.
Thank you.
So
you.
The next presentation we have this evening will be from Mr. Earl Miller regarding the YMCA.
Esta es otra presentación que van a hacer ahora sobre la organización, la YMCA, el YMCA y algunos de los servicios que dan.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening.
We'd like to thank the City Council for this time to present on the Newburgh Y project. I'm very happy to introduce the CEO of the Regional YMCA Association, Ira Bandansky, who could be with us tonight. If there's anyone capable of leading this project, Mr. Bandansky, with his 40 years of experience as a YMCA professional, planting, sustaining, and expanding YMCAs both in the urban and the suburban setting. We are very blessed to have him at the helm of this project. So without further ado, I'm going to let him tell you about the project we're working on.
Those words are going to cost me dinner. You know that. Okay. Again, Mayor Harvey, thank you. Karen,
my pleasure.
Torrance, Hillary, we met in the elevator, and the rest of the City Council, thank you for the opportunity. Bear with me a little bit. I'm kind of going through some physical things. So I promise not to fall asleep in the middle of speaking, because he'll push me and he'll give me the elbow. As Earl said, my life, my adult life, has been committed to YMCA work. And like some of you, and I guarantee many people in this community.
Keep
that aside?
No.
I didn't mean anything by it. I grew up in the YMCA in Boston and in a community very, very similar to this one. Very similar. Demographically a little different, but with similar struggles. And the Y meant a lot to me. And in many ways, kept me out of jail, kept me straight, kept me involved in sports, gave me mentors to make a difference in my life. And my work in the YMCA for these past years has been very much of really of paying it back, if you will. When I graduated school, I grew up in retail, it was just my mom and I had an opportunity to either run the first TJ Maxx literally in the country or start YMCA work. I chose YMCA work. So one of the things to tell you a little bit about, the misnomer, even though I'm the CEO of the YMCA of Middletown, my office is physically in Middletown, is we have the charter and the mission to provide services to all of Orange County and Sullivan County. And that changed essentially about 4 years ago when the Newburgh Y finally closed its doors. And the board, and Earl has served on that board on and off for quite a while, jumped at the opportunity and said, this community needs YMCA services. We just have to figure out what they need and how to do it. okay? But there was not a question as to whether the spirit and the commitment was there. And it has taken us a little bit of time, but, you know, over the past 4 months, this guy has done incredible work, meeting a lot of people in this community and building relationships. And one of the most important things, if you will, we're starting. Now, I know that's crazy. Here, you know, Torrance, you understand this. This YMCA was in Newburgh, 1866. It was a year after the Civil War. Think of that history. And it was thought of as a cutting-edge YMCA in a very cutting-edge community for years and years. And for a variety of reasons, okay, that's gone. We're here. Okay, two different organizations, if you will. We are picking up the service area. We have the same commitment as we do to any community in Orange County. And I would like to, I hope, to bring the kind of magic that we have brought to Middletown and call Joe, ask him.
Yeah.
And Earl will tell you, to this community. What's very important for us is a key step is things have changed in the past years. Since the Y, and you know this, Hillary, since the Y in its main building on Grand closed, what, almost 20 years ago, 19 years ago? A number of other not-for-profits have picked up services, you know, and so it's very, very key for us, first of all, to understand the community. When I say understand the community, I mean what the needs are of the community. And really find out what types of programs and services that we can insert, who we can partner with, you know, where we can find a room or get some gym space or whatever. And because our goal is not to, clearly, is not to replicate anything good that's going on, is to put our energies into working together with those who are having some success in changing the quality of life in this community, you know, or identify where the voids are and then insert ourselves, all right?
Yeah.
That's the way we operate, and that's the way I operate. So one of the things is very important to us, and I know a lot of you, I guarantee you, Torrance has had his, you're, Earl's had your arm here, right, for at least a month. And we have an event this Sunday at 4 o'clock at the Ritz. Lisa was good to us, gave us a nice little space there, and Earl has been putting invitations out. The focus of this event from 4 to 6, I don't know if it'll go to 6, but starts at 4, is to get people who are invested in this community, community leaders, anybody who wants to attend and come and talk to us about what the needs of the community are. We're there to listen, take notes, you know, be able to bring it back, you know, to the staff and figure out what we can, you know, what we can do. You know, we're lucky, and Karen knows this, you know, in particular. You know, one of the things that we were able to salvage, if you will, which has incredible history with this community, is Camp Robbins in Walden. In 1954, Camp Robbins was created to get kids out of the city and into an experience, an incredible camp experience, in a beautiful environment. And, you know, what your daughter gets to
and
experience.
And my daughter loves, yeah, she loved it.
Right, there you go. There's my commercial. I owe him dinner, and I owe her for the commercial.
I want to also...
Can I just say one thing while we're on the Camp Robbins thing? You are going to reopen Camp Robbins?
It's reopened.
Because I went there from when I was 5 till I was 15, and I was a camp counselor every summer, all 8 weeks.
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely best experience of my life. And I was so saddened to hear my children went there that it wasn't going to be open anymore. And then I heard recently that it was because...
It had one year of non-operation, right. Patricia,
yeah.
Because in between Newburgh closing And because we purchased it, meaning the YMCA of Middletown bought it, I was not going to let that camp, okay, not continue to be a YMCA camp.
Also, can I tell you that that was
so
the worst year?
So we had to scrape up the money. We had 1 year off, but we've operated for 2 years.
That year off, Simone had the worst camp experience ever.
Yeah.
That year that the camp was closed, we put her, enrolled her in a different camp, and that was the worst camp year that she had. And she was like, is it going to open up, Mom? She's like, do something.
Yeah, I just want to just kind of reiterate the fact that, one, I grew up in the YMCA in Poughkeepsie. And then when I moved to Newburgh in 1991, 28 years ago, I participated. I mean, Zion Lions used to be at the Y in Newburgh when I first moved here. And I remember Coach Rayford coaching, and I remember taking my nephews because I have younger nephews. And I moved here, I was about 19. My nephews were about 10 and 11 years old. And I always took them to the Y for the AAU, Summer Sizzler, the Winter Chills, and all that. And there were memorable moments in my family. And then I also remember kids going to Camp Robin as well. And I also remember, when you talk about needs of the city, I remember college students participating in doing team building activities at Camp Robin.
Oh, absolutely.
And even professional development, team building and team leadership activities. And that's something that Councilwoman Monteverde is talking about doing for, you know, the city council. Being able to go to a retreat, being able to find a facility close by for a retreat so that we can do some team building, some leadership building, and some camaraderie-like activities to make this council even more cohesive and so on. So, you know, I definitely support this effort. I've talked to Earl.
Sure.
We've met with Earl, Bob, you know. So whatever it is that I can do personally and the city council can do, we really would love this. Especially, and I want to say this for the youth, because as a young kid growing up, I used to look forward to getting my YMCA card. It was like, you got to get your library card. Right. And you get your, you know, talk about municipal IDs. Get your library card and get your YMCA card. And that meant something to me I was 6 years old, 7 years old. You know, I said, Mom, I got to get my YMCA card is expiring. I need to update it or whatever. And that meant something. It was a badge of honor.
Well, so. I can tell you that I'm dating myself here, but I went to Camp Robbins when it turned Camp Robbins. I remember the year it was Camp Isis because it's on the Osiris Country Club, and it was Isis Osiris.
Yeah, that's
Greek,
right. Yeah.
Yep, and it became Camp Robbins. I remember Mr. Robbins. I remember there was an uproar when they changed it to Camp Robbins from Camp Isis. But he was a benefactor. He was a very nice man, and he donated a lot of money to the Y, and that's how it became Camp Robbins.
Right. Yeah. So I want to add really quickly. I call him Brother Earl because I've known Earl for about 10 years now. So he's a very good friend of mine. So I appreciate him coming out. When I grew up, I grew up in a foster home. So I looked forward to going to Camp Robbins every single summer. I learned how to swim there. I started off as a tadpole and then the polywog and then, you know, the whole rigmarole there. So I'm very excited, very supportive of all the efforts. I do plan on being there Sunday right after my church service. I plan on being there and whatever else I can do. And I don't want to speak for all of council, but I think whatever else we can do to support this effort.
Now, let me ask you a couple quick tough questions, if I may, because that's my job, right, to ask the tough questions. And these are some legal matters. In terms of the YMCA, from what I understand, it is a 501c3.
It is. It's okay. A nonprofit organization.
Oh, it's a nonprofit organization.
It's the largest not-for-profit organization in the United States.
Okay. Now, the thing is, and here are the tough questions. Because I know you used to be on Grand Street. Mm-hmm. Let's say in a perfect utopian world, we did whatever we had to do with our due diligence, and the Y was brought on
back on board in the city of Newburgh, where would you go, and what type of services would you provide? I know you're going to do a needs assessment on Sunday, but where would you go? Because I know SUNY Orange just bought the building recently.
Well, I have some ideas about that, but we can talk later.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Okay. And then the other thing is, just keep this in mind. We've our city manager, myself, our corporate council, and the city council have been wrestling with this notion that the community, our constituents, are saying we need rateables, we need rateables, we need rateables, we need rateables, we need businesses that are going to help with the taxes and pay, you know, generate tax revenue so we can continue to work on our infrastructure, our roads, our curbs. You know, there's undeveloped land at the waterfront that has to be remediated in because of things under the ground and so on and so forth. And the discussion was, the last thing we need is another non-for-profit in Newburgh. Well, how do you respond to that?
Well, let me just say this, concern. If you come Sunday, you'll hear more about the impact of the YMCA, particularly the economic impact of the YMCA in communities. This particular association generates millions of dollars within communities. When we have work projects, we always hire local contractors. We always purchase from local vendors. We employ, was it 600 people?
Just about.
Across the region. And so the YMCA actually contributes to the economic development of the communities. There's studies that prove that communities with YMCA experience a quality of life and actually, in many instances, increase in the value, the home values, because of the presence of the YMCA. But again, on Sunday at 4 p.m. at the Rick Ritz Theater, we'll be talking more about the YMCA Association, who we are, what we have learned about the city of Newburgh, and then, of course, we're there to hear what the city of Newburgh tells us.
And that's excellent, and that's, thank you.
What I would like to say is that we welcome you guys back. You are much needed, and you do play a vital part in the economic development when it comes to our youth. And I say that because Newburgh Zion Lions, that was from my family, my husband and I, family coming together once you guys had left. So thank you for that. But we need this organization to run in the afternoon when the children are out of school. On the weekends, because Newburgh Zion Lions, we're still doing that, and we're hosting over 400 children. So if you know we can work together, and you get some of our ideas, and because there's no facility other than the what do you call it up there, Kaplan up there, the Armory.
Armory, yes.
Armory. But then it's like a selective.
Right.
Some people won't even go across town, either side of Broadway. So you're dealing with a lot of issues. So Sunday, I hope to be there. If not, I'll give you my business card and we can swap the information. So we welcome you back. And as a council, we will be talking among each other. We just need more of you. But not saying, you know, we're trying to stop you because it's not a rateable. We need something for our youth at night, weekends, holidays when school is out. And there are things in our community that are for our youth, but transportation issues and stuff like that. So we'll be talking with you.
So one of the things that I want to, and this I think will also help with what Mayor Harvey was asking. Here's a quick example. Right, of the community impact. 200 yards down Highland Avenue from the YMCA in Middletown, the main building there, there was a school. It was essentially the oldest elementary school in Orange County, Liberty Street, 1929. Bosie's occupied. The city rented the building to Bosie's, who we know has more money than... And they moved with the whole hospital building, OMC, and everybody knows what, you know, what happened. And so the building was sat empty for 2 years. And so your peer in Middletown called me up and said, Ira, you know, I got something to show you. And went over on a rainy Friday night and brought some of my staff. We looked at it. I got together with RECAP. And the executive director then, Chuck Darden, was a friend of mine, a close friend of mine. And we looked at the possibility of purchasing that building together and having Head Start program and YMCA. As it was, we needed more than half the space. So Chuck lost on that one. RECAP gets the next one, I promised. And we ended up purchasing the building. It's right in the middle of a very heavy residential area. That school has 250 kids a day, from preschool to universal pre-K to after-school programs, all right? And we run a summer camp there, all right? And we repaired the building, we renovated. It was a dump, and the grounds were a dump. Now it's a beautiful youth community center in the middle of Middletown that serves a walk-to population. And Middletown demographically has changed dramatically, just as Newburgh has. And, you know, we'll be new population that we want to serve. So that's a good example of economic impact. I understand we don't pay the taxes. And, you know, and but it just as Earl said, up until 2008, when the YMCA built a new building, all right? We're not at that point. We're not talking about that. Even just brought in a lot of services. You know what the property values within a half a mile would go up by? 10 to 15% the minute I opened the door. And I built new Ys in Keene, New Hampshire, and in Boston, and actually started one in Monroe.
Okay,
that's been in operation for 9 years.
So,
and so it does have, and we employ people, we train young people. Right. All of those things have a value.
So Ira and Step one, Earl, I want to thank
Sunday.
You.
Well,
thank
we support. We
yes,
support.
We support it. Thank you.
Thank you. I just want to say thank you, Councilwoman Monteverde, and Councilman Grice. Mayor and the full council, thank you for the time this evening, and we do invite each and every one of you, as well as community members, to our event. If it's okay, I'd like to leave flyers,
pass them down.
As well as on the table
pass them
downstairs.
Over there.
If
great.
I could,
yeah,
thank you.
Great. So, el señor, como les dije, esta es una presentación de la YMCA para algunos de los servicios que están tratando de traer acá a la ciudad de Newburgh. Van a tener una sección de información que el señor va a pasar el boletín. Y va a ser el domingo de 4 a 6 en el Ritz Theater aquí en Broadway, el 107 Broadway.
Again, thank you.
Gracias.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Gracias.
Earl, can you pass some of those out? Just, yeah. Just take one and pass it down.
Next item on the agenda this evening is rehabilitation of Washington Lake Intake Gatehouse. We're also going to combine the next item.
Jason, do the two items together.
Good evening. The next two agenda items pertain to the rehabilitation of the Washington Lake Gatehouse. The Washington Lake Gatehouse was constructed in 1909. It's positioned roughly in the middle of Washington Lake, and its purpose is to house valves, screens, and raw water transmission mains to allow the conveyance of water from Washington Lake to the filtration plant. The gatehouse is constructed of reinforced concrete, brick, and wood. Over time, this gatehouse has fallen into disrepair to the point where there's a hole in the ceiling and some other deficiencies with the windows, doors, and other appurtenances inside the structure. So the first resolution on the agenda is to declare this project a Type 2 action regarding SEAKER, meaning that no further environmental review is necessary. The rehabilitation work involves the in-kind replacement of the roof, doors, and other appurtenances, and it's categorically exempt under DEC law. The second resolution is to award a bid for the rehabilitation construction project to Doyle Construction in the amount of $419,700. And that is including an add alternate in the bid. Any questions?
Where are the funds coming from?
The funds are coming from the 2016 ban.
That was approved.
So this was a capital plan project. Right. And so we've done the design, done the environmental review, and now we're ready to move on construction. So it's another step in the process of that proposed plan from 2015.
Right. Excellent.
Right.
All right, thank you.
16.
Thank you.
The ban was 16, but the capital plan was approved in 2015.
Thank you, Jason. Thank you, Wayne. Well, the next item this evening, we're going to discuss pilot agreement with RUPCO.
Yeah, so this is following up from the presentation at the last work session for the phase, I guess it's the phase two, affordable housing project that
come on up, guys.
You guys,
Melanie.
So you had a presentation at the last work session, and we talked about the parameters of the development, the scope of the development, the sources of funding for the development, and the where the payment in lieu of taxes piece fits into the planning planning and financing mm-hmm. of the project. And we know that there were some ranges that were proposed, and we think we've proposed an agreement that fits within the ranges that the council was suggesting and that would fit with RUPCO's parameters. And we know you're not all that thrilled with the names, so there's you'll see some brackets and some other things, but essentially the entities have to be that enter into this type of agreement under the private housing finance law, they have to be certain types of entities. So the names may be a little fluid, but they have to be partnerships and they have to be housing development fund companies, and those things won't change.
Okay. So what I do have a few, looking at this now, I do have a few follow-up questions. However, Councilwoman Rayford was not here for some of those discussions, considering she had some other pressing matters. So I do want to defer to Councilwoman Rayford to see if she had any questions or thoughts about this before, or you need.
I just want to know the years of how many years of the pilot that they're asking. And, you know, with law, on the law side, Michelle, how many years are, you know, this municipality normally?
We understand that pilots are not the most popular transaction in the city of Newburgh. This particular pilot would grant, this particular agreement would grant the tax exemption for the project for 17 years, which is probably the minimum that the project would be able to support and still be successful. So I think they've met the city's objectives in that regard. And so the property, the payment in lieu of the taxes would be in place for that 17 years. So there would be payments in the construction phase that are somewhat lower. And then once the properties are rehabilitated, certificates of occupancy are issued and they're brought online, those pilot payments would increase First, they would increase substantially and then incrementally over the life of the pilot until the tax exemption is phased out.
What kind of phase are you talking about? How many, what percentage? What are the exact amount of the taxes that will be paid?
Okay, so if you look at, you have the resolution, which is two pages, and then the next document there is the actual agreement. And if you look at the numbered paragraphs, we start in paragraph two, that gives you the term of the pilot. It says the tax exemption will operate for a period of 17 years measured from the city's first taxable status date following the Housing Development Fund Company's acquisition of the property. So that's the commencement date of the pilot. The next, in paragraph three, it gives you the breakdowns. So there's a residential property component, and for the construction phase, the payment in lieu of taxes for the first 2 years would be $35,000. And then into that third year of ownership, that would rise to $73,200 and then increase 2% annually thereafter. Then you have the separate arrangement for the not-for-profit community space property, and that would be a flat $15,000 in the years of construction. It would then be $15,000 a year after the certificate of occupancy is issued, and then that would rise 2% annually.
Do we have those numbers on a chart?
I believe that there were charts provided. I did not.
It's not in the resolution.
The charts are not in the resolution.
Can we pull
not
that
in agreement. Up? I don't know that. I don't have it.
I don't believe we have that material available to pull up.
So how are we going to consider in a work session, if we're in a work session, and we're trying to look at these numbers, mm-hmm. in terms of payments in lieu of taxes, et cetera, it should be presented on a chart so that we can see this. That's why we're here in a work session, because when we get back here on Monday,
it's a vote.
So, Repco, are you guys having prepared any kind of chart for us to look at it? Because it's definitely not charted out here in our resolution.
We weren't told to bring one, but we can provide you one tomorrow morning or even tonight.
I mean, for me, I'm a visual learner.
Yeah,
right?
We would like to see.
I understand. We'll get you a chart in advance of Monday's meeting.
And this is, when you say $35,000 a year, this is, well, wasn't there five properties involved?
So there's a total,
there's 22.
Once the subdivision of 116 Lander is finalized, there will be a total of 24 properties, 22 residential, and two... job training, community center, daycare facility.
All right, so
that's Exhibit A on the resolution, Patty. You can see all the parcels listed.
I saw that.
Right.
Yeah.
But the other night I thought we spoke about five properties in particular.
Those five properties perhaps that you might be mentioning are regarding the demolitions that were done.
No, that's not. It was the church and it was... a few other properties. That's what I'm talking about, those five properties.
So that's only two properties? That's 245 Liberty Street and 257 Liberty Street.
Then, yeah, Melanie knows what I'm talking about.
98 Andrew Street, 109
right.
First Street, the burn down.
That's 197.
197
First yeah. Street. Oh, you mean the ones that are in the presentation?
Yes.
That's yeah. 98 Lander.
I know these are a separate issue, but...
Or you're talking about the ones that are being subdivided, the 114, the 116, the 118.
The church that she's going to be a part of. Those were five properties you presented to us. I think what we all want to see is we just want to see it all laid out on somewhere.
Yeah.
It's very convoluted, so to speak, and I think everybody agrees. We just want to see all the properties, what the actual breakdown of all the taxes are every year.
Right.
Didn't we get that?
No.
No.
No, it's not here.
Yeah, so we could go, because my understanding, Michelle, and correct me if I'm wrong, Mr. Donut, initially the pilot was a 15-year pilot.
No, 32. We started at 32.
We started at 32.
We started at 30.
Then
it, okay. And we talked about the range. So the maximum was the original request was at 30. We talked about what the minimum would be to make the pilot work. It had to be at least 15.
15, I thought.
And then, so we talked about that range. And when we talked about next steps, we talked about how to find what I termed as the sweet spot that would help RUPCO achieve its financial goals to make the project viable and still meet the city's concerns.
So, it went
so
to
if
17.
You're talking about a range of a 32 versus 15, I think RUPCO has more than attempted to accommodate the city's need for the minimum term of the pilot. Okay. At 17.
So that's
17 is only 2 years longer than the minimum.
Right.
And the original proposal was at 30, which would have been almost double that.
All right. So in the 17 years, what are the numbers? What are the
$1.6 million in revenue.
I'll say that again.
It's $1.6 million in revenue total.
To the city. And over 17 years, right? Now, what happens after the 17 years?
We're going to have to come back to you and ask for another pilot.
So that brings me back to my other point. So that was why I asked for, in the 15 years or 17 years, that we made it clear that the people that were renting that property would be able to then try to purchase that property. So I think that's a very important key for me, because home ownership is important, or
Property ownership. If it continued as a rental property, we would have to come back and ask you for another pilot. If it was offered to the tenants, which is part of a regulatory agreement that we would sign with New York State Homes and Community Renewal, we would, if the tenants are interested in doing that, we would work with them to train them so that they could learn how to be homeowners, to maintain their homes, as well as help them with down payment assistance, because we do have that at RUPCO. So we do have those kind of programs at RUPCO.
Right. And so I'm going to agree with Mayor Harvey. I do need to see the numbers a little bit more visually.
Yes.
My other comment, though, while I have the microphone, is that community space. I really want to see some kind of written kind of plan to ensure that it's going to be a community space. So that everyone throughout the city of Newburgh can be able to partake in that.
So it looks like, Michelle, you do the one, if it's 1.6 divided by 17, that's roughly about 94 per year.
70.
It's 72. You're starting at a minimum of 72,000.
72,000.
For the residential.
73 for the residential. There's 22 residential properties.
Right.
So you're talking about a minimum in the first year after construction of 73,200.
1,200 a unit.
2 years after construction, right?
So 2 years after construction.
73 what?
73,200.
Uh-huh.
And each year after. Uh-huh. So in the later 15 years of the pilot, it's going to escalate 2% every year on that number. So you've got 73,200, 2% on that. Then it's going to be another. And then the following year, it's another 2% on that number. And so keeping the term at a on the shorter side is nobody's boxed themselves in long term to this particular arrangement. So if 15 years down the line, maybe five properties do end up in home ownership, maybe 2% escalation is not an appropriate figure anymore. Maybe it needs to be larger, maybe it needs to be smaller. So by keeping the pilot term at the lower end of the term, it gives the council and the developer the opportunity to revisit the pilot at an earlier stage. And you may not need all of it. You may be able to sweeten it. So there are things to do. If you start off granting a longer pilot, you're locked in for that longer period of time. So there is some advantage in that regard, is that you know, given the time spread, you would have a much sooner opportunity to reevaluate the value of the pilot to the project and a value of the pilot to the city.
So, and then the commercial or the community space, that's at 15K, correct?
Yes, and a 2%. And that, yeah, after a certificate of occupancy issues for that property, that also has a 2% escalation on it as well.
So it's about 20,000 square feet, right, at 15K?
It's a little bit more than that.
Okay.
And how long is construction?
Construction is anticipated to be about 2 years on the residential properties. The community space, we're using the issuance of the certificate of occupancy as the trigger date, so it doesn't say 1 year or 2 years for the commercial.
And so what would be the classification for the community space?
It could be assembly, could be mixed use, it could be, you know, there's going to be a building code. There's going to be what's permitted by zoning. And then there's also going to be a building code determination. So depending on what the end use is, mm-hmm. it could be classified as an assembly use. It could be classified as a mixed commercial residential use, retail, you know, depends on, you know, if it's going to be like something like performing arts, it's going to more likely be assembly. It could, you know, if it's going to be a gallery or it's going to be a community meeting house, or you're going to have other services there, maybe it's office retail,
right,
or office professional, or, you know, whatever, a daycare center or some other classification, right, of any other building.
Right. So, and that's why I had my
so the
point.
End use is going to really dictate, right, what the CO says.
Exactly.
Right. And then, okay. Yeah, no, I understand all that. I was just trying to make sure that we had the that it's at 15 for the commercial space.
Mm-hmm. Now, in terms of the 22 residential, are those going to be strictly rentals, or will some of them be?
It's an affordable housing rental.
So none will be co-opted, or people won't have an opportunity to purchase?
Yeah, so that's why, so on the two things, that's why I was saying that community space, however that's used, is going to be important. That is very open to the community, and then in the 15 years that the people have that opportunity to purchase.
Oh, they do after the 15 years?
After the 15
years. Have an opportunity to purchase? Oh, okay, that's great. Now, in terms of your timeline, so let's say, and Michelle may be able to input on this. So if the resolution carries on Monday, mm-hmm. what are the next steps, number one? And then I'm always asking when a shovel's going in the ground.
Okay, well,
I'm always asking that.
The agreement, once it's approved, the agreement can be signed almost, you know, in short time thereafter. Once we have all the appropriate names of all the entities, so this execution, the signing of the pilot would happen almost immediately in real time. Then, as the project commences, we're looking at taxable status date. So taxable status date for this year has already, for next year has already passed. Taxable status date is March 1st of every calendar year. So the 2020 taxable status date has already passed. So they would have to acquire the property, and then we would have to look at the next available taxable status date, and that would commence the exemption.
Gotcha. Okay.
But it all depends on whether or not we get funded.
I'm sorry.
Right.
Say
so
again.
This is the whole
contingent on funding from
right.
New York State Homes and Community Renewal.
Right.
So and we need this pilot in order to get that funding.
This pilot is a piece of a larger funding
it.
Stream.
Gotcha.
The primary source of which is going to be coming from a state agency in the form of tax credits and other incentives.
So we can kind of map out the numbers. So we can have visuals and then also some timeline, you know?
Yeah, we can write that timeline out if you'd rather than me saying it.
Okay.
I can do that
too.
But in terms of a timeline, the state notifies developers of awards usually in June. So if we are awarded, then a construction closing could happen in the fall, could happen in the winter, but most likely in the fall. And then construction would start, we're saying, in January.
Right. And so, and then your first taxable status date would occur immediately there. It would be March 1st of that next year. So that's when all of this, that's when this would all kick in.
But if we are not awarded in June, we will reapply in October for the early award, and then notifications of that award are made in January of 2020. And then we would have a construction closing in April and start construction soon after, so May of, or June of 2020.
Okay. So if you were awarded in June and construction started as you prescribed
in January of
2020, what will be the final rendering?
Right.
Well, what do you anticipate would be?
2022.
Yeah,
2022. Okay.
Yeah. So we count on a 2-year time frame to get at the end of construction. So that's why it's expressed as a 17-year term. The state obviously is looking to the pilot as an evidence of local support for this project, and that's why they put so much emphasis on this work that we're doing with you tonight.
Gotcha. Thank you. That's all for me.
And that if this resolution passes, someone from the city of Newburgh needs to notify New York State Homes and Community Renewal.
As long as we have the contact information, we're happy to do that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hey, and just a quick question. So for the resolution on Monday, are we putting dates? Because if not, they're going to have to come back. Let's say, right, I always like to prepare for all possibilities, right? So you don't get the first round.
They would have to reapply, which I would speculate that if they don't get funded, they would consider this particular agreement kind of finished, and you would have to, they would probably want a fresh resolution to go with a fresh application.
Yeah, that is our experience. We typically would want to come back and correct that and revise the pilot to conform to the new schedule. Okay. If we have to go back into another funding round.
They're going to want the most up-to-date resolution, and you know, if you don't get funded, there may be an opportunity to find out why and what, you know, what aspects of the project maybe need to be tweaked or improved, and that may also necessitate some modifications to the funding stream and the funding pieces. So I think they would come back if they were not funded in this round.
Just wanted to, if I could, for a second, go back to Councilman Grice's question. I believe that we provided a copy of our commitment to the state, which is included in our application, for the opportunity for tenants to buy out the project and retire the debt, that whatever's remaining at a point that they are inclined to do so. And that was a firm commitment from us, signed by us in that application. Did you have a chance to see that?
I did.
Great.
Just wanted to mention it publicly.
Okay. And then 17 is that's the magic number from the housing, right? Housing renewal.
The 17 years, that's what you're referring to? Yeah, the rationale for that, I think, has been clearly stated. It's a 2-year term, accounting for the 2 tax years of that cover the 18 months of construction, and the pilot then really commences at its full value on the tax rolls, based on $1,200 a door, basically, is the way it was calculated, for each residential unit, and all of the residential properties in aggregate, they compound, think about it as a compound increase over the next 14 years. It amounts to about 28% over that term of 15 years after through the term of the pilot, that it will increase in terms of being a revenue stream to the city. Plus, that's not expressing the fact that we're taking a property which is currently a church, entirely off the tax rolls for its entire life, and adding that to the tax rolls, so that does contribute to the burden that other taxpayers in the city certainly are aware of.
Thank you
very much.
Thanks, Mel.
Thank
you. See you on Monday. I don't know. Yes. All the information you need. Yeah. All right. Before that. The next item this evening is a purchase of 17 William Street, and we're also going to discuss simultaneously or shortly thereafter the purchase of 35 Oak Street.
Tammy.
Hi.
Sorry.
Let's talk about
the purchase of 17 William Street is a resolution to authorize the conveyance of real property known as 17 William Street, a private sale to Scott Raphael for the amount of $52,000.
Thank you. So this is the purchase of a home on William Street. It's in the middle of a block, a not very stable block right now, but Mr. Raffaelli, who is here with me, is hoping to renovate this property, move there, and we're excited to have him. This was, again, done through our realtor, and with the 30-day preliminary look-see for owner-occupants. He has a business as well, and eventually, I think, is hoping to potentially move that business up as well, but start with one property at a time.
That's great. That's on what block?
This is your woodworking industry.
Questions, comments?
Recycling?
Yes.
Okay.
It's very cool.
Excellent. Good.
Yeah.
That's in Ward.
We support owner-occupancy.
It's Ward.
Where are you from, sir?
What is that?
Oh, Brooklyn.
Brooklyn.
Oh, sorry. I live in Brooklyn.
A furniture place.
I'm from Brooklyn.
Oh, okay. What part?
I live in Park Slope right now.
So.
Welcome to Newburgh.
Thank you.
What ward is that?
I'm sorry?
Ward 2.
Is it Ward 2 or 3? Because I know some of 3.
I think it's my ward.
I don't. Is it 2? Okay. William, is it?
It's 2?
I like
okay.
That table.
Right?
Happy shopping. Yep. Lots going on William.
Habitat is there.
Yeah.
Really cool stuff.
Yeah.
You're thinking of opening a shop up here?
I'd like to try, I'd like to try.
Have you been to Atlas?
No, I haven't. I did hear about it.
Yeah,
and,
you should check it out.
Yeah, definitely. I want to check it out. Yeah. I mean, what I've been doing is just coming up every time I have free time. So I actually have a business and I have to work. So it's difficult, but, you know, we make it up here and try and get it, trying to move.
That's a great building, too.
It is. Yeah. It's beautiful.
Yeah. I'm going to bring it back.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Bravo. Thank you.
See you on Monday.
Sorry, waited so long for that.
Wow. It's a lot of work.
Thank you. Next item, we're going to discuss 35 Oak Street.
And is Mr. Hinostroza here? No? Okay. So this one is a single-family house. This was put, again, sold by the realtor. It was on the 30-day look-see. We got no owner-occupants, and it went back for another 30 days. We still got no owner-occupant, but we thought this proposal was great and wanted to bring it forward anyway. It's a single-family house. Mr. Hinostroza is going to keep it as a single-family house. He's going to renovate it and then hopefully find an owner-occupant. So, again, because it's not an owner-occupant at this point, but there are people who aren't necessarily willing to take on a renovation, and so it's nice sometimes where we can potentially give them the opportunity to get a fixed up property. So again, you know, I know there's the preference. We did try for an additional 30 days, so again for 60 days.
Ellie, it looks like it has mold. Are they going to have to do remediation?
Exactly. It's not in great shape. It's not in terrible shape. It seems structurally fine, but yes, there's significant amounts of mold in the lowest level.
Right. Wow.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ellie.
That is Oak, 35 Oak.
Moving forward, we're going to discuss a number of different grants that the city will be going after. First of which is Summer Youth Employment Program or Summer Youth Employment Grant. It's going to be authorizing the city manager to enter into an agreement with the county for summer youth employment and training program to provide people throughout the city with employment temporarily.
So I'm passing around the draft of the grant. It wasn't ready at the time of notice, but it was ready this morning, so I printed them out for you all. This is an annual grant that we do through the county. It gets local youth employed both at the rec, so you'll see there's, I'm going to do it wrong, camp counselors, lifeguards. It's all in the grant.
Pass it down, okay. Is there more copies?
There should be. There's 10 copies, so there should be plenty for everyone. And then additionally, two admin staff that work out of our office. So people have, the youth have a option to kind of apply for the different jobs that they may find useful in their future life. And we've had great luck, both my department and Derek's.
Could you add one more?
Yeah, so they were added in my department or in?
Well, I would be, once upon a time, I hosted one, and I'd like to do that again for this summer.
Yes, so this has not been in yet. This is just the draft that we did this morning. I will defer to our Corporation Counsel if she can amend the.
Yeah, so we've amended the resolution twice now. Originally, it was going to be 12 participants, but the Recreation Department wanted to add four more, so we're up to 16. So I can make it 17.
Yeah, this is actually the one I had reached out to you about.
So what we'll need is who will, and you'll see it in the grant application, we'll need one of those chunks filled out. So who, you know, all the information based on.
I'll get that to
around
you.
Who will be the advisor.
And me.
So there was a notice that I received about Orange County Youth Employment.
That's what
this is?
Yes. Yes.
So we have to apply for a grant to hire kids?
It's not really a grant. It's a program, and you have to make an application to the program. We do it every year.
Oh, and we usually get it?
Yeah, yes. Yes.
Yeah.
All right. Now, how many kids are
typically
employed?
I think at this point we're at 3 admin and 14 rec. Is that the correct numbers?
14
yeah.
Rec?
Yeah. We're right now our application is up to we're looking 17. For 17 participants.
Oh, great. Okay. Because I know I posted that on social media earlier, and I know people are going to be asking because I had saw it.
So they have to apply through the county.
Oh, through the county.
Yeah.
Okay.
You have to make the application through the county. The county is technically the employer.
Right.
They provide the bodies. We provide the work. And the
checks
does,
come from the county.
Yeah, and the county it provides the insurance coverages and the payment.
Now, it used to be private industry council, PIC, and there was another, I guess they changed the names.
This has been Summer Youth Employment at least for the last 10 years that I can recall. Some other workforce development grants that are out there. So, for example, Best Resources also manages a grant that also places provides employment opportunities. This is for youth on the younger side of the spectrum. As Best usually provides for a slightly older group.
So what is the age range for this group?
This one, I think, is 16?
14 to 20.
Oh. And Best Resources usually focuses on 17 and 18 to 25. So that between the two programs, you cover a nice range of young people.
One other quick question about employment, youth employment. Mm-hmm. Is Is this the only youth employment opportunities that the city offers? Is there anything else?
As Ms. Kelson said, there's also, through Best Resources, some that are placed at DPW.
At DPW, right, because yeah, so I was going to...
Seasonal positions as well.
So there's some seasonal positions. We like to hire through the county. I know that Public Works and the Water Department, Ms. Best has reached out to those departments in particular so that... focusing on getting those the people in her program into those more physical jobs.
And we passed a resolution in support of that about 2 months ago, correct?
That was for a winter program. She manages a series of grants, and they tend to run by season. So that was like a winter spring season. Mm-hmm. I did speak to her directly yesterday. She's gonna she's gonna come back to me with her summer program. And so there'll be a second resolution.
Also, there were some youth working with Deirdre Glenn.
That's this program. Yeah, yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you, Ali. The next item we're going to discuss this evening, DCJS Give Grant. We'll let the chief talk further. Obviously, this is a terrific program. And this will be an authorization to apply for and accept.
Good evening. This is the sixth year of the Give Grant. The county is eligible for a total of $848,000. We'll be applying for approximately $427,000 of that pot. The Give Grant pays for a variety of things, and this grant is at the nucleus of our crime prevention efforts. Due to this grant, this is sort of the heart and lungs of what of our ability to bring the crime rate down here in Newburgh, combined with other things, of course. So this grant pays for a field intelligence officer, which is a detective, pays for our crime analyst, pays for hotspot policing, which is foot patrols and motor patrols in what we've identified as our short-term and long-term hotspots. This grant also pays for the YPI program, which is the program that the young people go through. It's a week-long program that we've administered, and we've put thousands of kids through that program since it started. This also pays for confidential funds for gun and drug buys, enforcement action overtime, and a few other things.
Doesn't it also pay for the SNUG program?
Excuse me, the what?
The SNUG. No?
I'm not familiar with the SNUG. SNUG, you said?
Yes.
No, it doesn't.
Okay.
So now the district attorney's office also gets a portion of this money, as well as the Orange County Sheriff's Department, and they work in collaboration with us on our efforts.
Perfect. Thank you, Chief.
Thank you.
Next item we're going to discuss is the non-fatal shooting initiative.
Again, this is a critical component of our crime reduction efforts here in Newburgh. This grant pays the full salary and benefits for a detective, and that person's duties are what the premise of the grant is to ensure that non-fatal shootings get the same type of attention and an investigatory effort that homicides would get. So we work in conjunction with a DA's office investigator who works regularly in our department, and this grant pays for, like I said, a full-time detective salary and all fringe benefits as well.
Thank you.
Again, another terrific program that's taking place. Thank you, Chief.
Thank you.
Next item this evening, we're going to be discussing Endeavor Municipal Development Agreement. As you remember, there was a grant presentation a few weeks ago by Victor Cornelius, and this resolution will be authorizing three separate agreements with his business for grant consulting services in the amount of $24,000 per agreement for 12 months.
What happened to Millennium?
Expired. We decided not to renew their application. This was...
Well, we voted to have them I don't remember hearing that we had a vote to get rid of them and not renew it. Did I miss something?
They had a contract. The contract has ended.
I don't think that we were going to renew it. I mean, they didn't bring in a lot of grants.
Did they come to us and ask us to renew it, or that's what I'm just saying. I've only missed one work session, so.
Sure. Yes. I mean, I
don't remember.
I have had discussions with Millennium, and we have discussed this as well, and we decided not to renew the contract. Certainly, if the council would like to consider that, we could.
They were more expensive, weren't they? They were more expensive. Yeah,
they were another
$12,000.
Okay.
They were about the same. To be quite honest, I wasn't that impressed with Millennium. I've worked with Endeavor before for transparency. I've seen their work. They present it, so.
No.
I think the recommendation is from, at least from the staff side, is that we didn't feel Millennium really provided the extra resources that and the return that I think we expected.
Right.
And I wasn't here for the work session where Endeavor did present, but it was presented as an alternative to renewing with Millennium.
Right.
And so what you have in your packets are three separate contracts to cover different areas. I had provided some red line comments, which have been accepted. That's what the final contract will look like. And we just need to know whether you support that decision and want us to put a resolution on for Monday night.
I do have a question because I just bring mm-hmm. me up to speed because I remember that the city was on a spending freeze, and I know that we have a new comptroller, and I know that he's over his head with a lot of stuff that was open and hasn't been closed. And I agree, I haven't seen a great performance with the other
Millennium.
Organization.
Millennium.
Yeah. And I wasn't pleased at all. They sounded good, but the performance was not to my expectations anyway. So if you can...
Sure. You know, I can't speak necessarily to Millennium's performance. I haven't been here during that time. However, I have reviewed a number of different documents they prepared for us. As I've said previously, I think Millennium has secured one or two grants on behalf of the city. Certainly not a lot as it relates to all of the different matters they were tasked with. However, as it relates to Endeavor, we have determined where the funding will come from three separate areas, water, sewer, and general, which will be the three different topics and areas that Endeavor will focus their grants on initially, and they will be working to expand upon that as time goes on. Any further questions related to finances or spending freezes, I will let Comptroller answer.
And actually, Millennium was double what Endeavor is. So it was $3,500 a month, wasn't it?
It was. I thought it was.
Yeah.
Go ahead,
okay.
Mr.
Bentley.
That's
good.
Yep.
Put it on. All right. Just to answer your question, Councilwoman, Millennium was $3,250 a month.
Okay.
Right. That's
so
what we're
almost
paying.
Double, yeah. Okay.
And just to speak to your question, Councilwoman Rayford, Millennium, so the grants coordinator actually works in my office as well. Millennium didn't secure anything for us that we could not have secured for ourselves. So there was absolutely zero gain there. And just speaking to Endeavor, I was at the work session. They've done some great work over in Wappingers and some other areas in the immediate vicinity.
They've done work in Poughkeepsie as well. I mean, they've done work throughout the Hudson Valley.
Yeah. Right. So the idea was we didn't renew the contract because there were zero results. And anything they did get us, we actually could have gotten ourselves. And so there was just other opportunity here, and the guys were really good. And as the city manager mentioned, the money is in the budget. It's fully able to be funded.
Okay.
And because of the different sources, it's actually going to be cheaper to the general fund than Millennium was.
Okay. Thank you.
Great.
Okay.
Perfect. Thank you. I believe the fire chief had to step out. I'll speak on this matter for him.
Yeah, I can speak on either one.
The fire department surplus equipment, as you know, there's a number of different radios that the fire department has now listed as surplus. They're looking to do what they need to do in order to let other city departments and agencies use those materials.
Right. So they have an entirely new radio system, and so this equipment is no longer needed. And if they can surplus it and either sell it to another municipality, that revenue could be put back in for them to use for other equipment.
Sounds good.
The next item is a Habitat Student Art Project.
We submitted this on behalf of Councilman Grice, just to make sure that the city staff would be able to support the proposed project. So the students of the school district are collaborating with Habitat for Humanity to create art that would adorn, be affixed to the vacant buildings prior to their renovations. And Chief Horton had some concerns about the board up procedures that are in the city code. So working with Chief Horton, working with Architectural Review Commission, because the properties are in the historic district, we've come up with a little plan, and the resolution would just show that the council is supportive of that plan and allow the chief to be able to make sure that the buildings comply with the code to the best of his ability.
So I saw this being done in, I forget, it was another city that I saw it being done, where the houses that were needed to be boarded up, where people had put artwork on those, just on the boarded up parts of that. So I thought that this would be a good idea. Of course, for full disclosure, as my full-time job, I facilitate an after-school program. So I had the resources there. I did invite Corey Allen from Habitat for Humanity in case anyone wanted to ask him some questions about it. We do have the wood. It's already secured, and the dimensions of that and how many and which schools they're going to. The only thing that I need is, and I was waiting before I send out the notice to those teachers because I wanted some security, but it is time sensitive as I have to order paint and those other things.
Okay. Do they have to sign a waiver because they're stepping on these
All the properties are Habitat owned. They're not city owned properties.
Okay.
And Habitat is fully cooperative with that. They made the application to the ARC.
Yes. Yeah, we have precedent for this. We've done this with the land bank buildings. Shouldn't be a problem.
Okay. I was going to say this because the kids aren't going to hang them up themselves. Paint them in our.
They're painting the art, and then the art's going to be affixed to the boards on the windows. And it's just a little bit of a beautification. Yeah.
Thank you, Habitat, for wanting to do this. We did it with the land bank.
Great idea.
Thank you. Chief Horton had some concerns about the board of procedure in the code. And so working through some of these weeds, getting really into the weeds, we wanted to make sure that he had a level of comfort so that his duties as building inspector weren't affected. Mm-hmm. So that's the real reason for the resolution.
So can I send that email out tomorrow?
Yes, you can send it now.
Thank you. Yes. it's in draft form, just waiting.
The lead service line replacement will be a resolution authorizing the city council to support additional funding for just that lead service line replacement. Similarly, the next item as well will be a water infrastructure structure, which will be a resolution authorizing the support of funding for that regard as well, too.
Wayne, how much we've used up the first grant?
We have about 56 approved applications. Senator Larkin, before he retired, did give us additional funding, so we just got approved this week for another $155,000, and applications are coming in almost every day.
Well, I can tell you that I've sent a number of people from my ward, and they've told and a lot of them have gone through with a couple people in towns and different places. I sent somebody to you today too, and every single one of them called me back and said that they. Everybody was really good at the water department. It was very respectful and very responsive, and I haven't had any complaints of all the people I sent down there. So thank you.
Job well done, Wayne. Thank you. The last two items are listed under appointments. We have IDA appointments, a resolution for four people to fill vacancies on the board of directors for the city of Newburgh IDA.
Three.
And then the board of ethics appointment.
Again, these were submitted to my office from the executive director of the IDA. There have been vacancies created by resignations, and you have the letters of interest of the three individuals that the IDA is recommending that you appoint. And then in the Board of Ethics, I think we appointed two new, reappointed one, and this would be a fourth member.
Who's the ethics?
Patrick Bardinelli.
I thought he was on the police advisory board.
Not in a very long time.
Oh, okay.
So who is on the ethics board now?
You appointed Barbara Smith and Nicholas Valentine. You reappointed, Valerie Larry. And I think Nancy Cole she's not interested. So this would, we had two more spots.
Pat Berardinelli would be one, and then
he would be one of them, and then we would need one more person to serve on. But at least you'd have four, and they'd be able to transact business on a regular basis.
Is there a reason why his name isn't on the resolution?
Because I probably copied an old one, and it's there in the now be it there resolved.
The resume's in
at the bottom
package.
Well, the only problem I have is it has to be
in the electronic version.
It's in the electronic version?
Yeah.
Okay.
I was on the ethics board for a number of years, and it has to be a certain amount of political parties.
No, it does not.
It did before, so I don't know when
board
that changed.
The Board of Ethics specifically does not have a party status. When they revive, one of the things that the Board of Ethics did and had the city do is adopt a new model, adopt the state model code of ethics for municipalities in 2015. And one of the things that you don't address is political parties.
That's not what I'm just telling you what I was told when I went on the ethics board. Patty,
when you were on the ethics board, that was when we did the revisions to the local law and adopted the model ethics. And I remember distinctly talking about that political parties could not be a factor in, and we adopted the state model code of ethics. And so it's not a matter of political party. You just have to be a resident of the city of Newburgh.
Okay.
If there are any further comments or questions, we will, do I have a motion to go into an executive session?
So moved.
Second.
I'll second it.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.